So we've got a couple of tsuba and some other fittings here. We'll start with this moko shaped tsuba. Moko is, of course, this four lobed section. It's so named, it's after a type of melon or gourd plant. In any case, it's shakudo. It, as you can see, it's seen better days. An awful lot of the patina has been worn away. I think it's been over-cleaned. There's a suspicion that it might have had some chemicals applied. We're not entirely sure if the rim was originally gold, but in discussion with the owner, we've decided that I'll polish off these traces of gilding and rework it. It's a fairly classical motif, dragon rising above Mount Fuji. Late Edo period, a further indicator that it's late is the plating style. It's not foil or anything like that. Very tidy work. It's unsigned. Waves are quite fun, quite dynamic, quite bold, little dragon in the waves on the back. The Nanako, as you can see, is super fine. Very refined Nanako work. Nanako, of course, often being performed by specialist Nanako workers. That's all they did. Can you imagine? How was work today, love? Oh, a lot of dots. But there you go. That's the nature of classical Kinko work. So this is going to require some fairly extensive repolishing to redevelop the pattern. You can't just dunk it in some chemicals and magically restore things. So where everything's tarnished badly, that metal needs to be repolished so that it reveals fresh alloy. That must be done very carefully so as not to lose detail, engraving and so forth. Where I can, I try to preserve the original pattern, so these areas I'll leave well alone. And then blend the patina in, and where the gold is worn on the piece itself, I will try and restore that. But as I say, the rim we've decided will probably look better were it polished black, just to a straight black patina again. So that's that. I look forward to seeing this one finished. I think it'll be quite a transformation. Shouldn't take too long. So here's another shakudo tsuba, aoigata shape, saddle flap shape. This is another level in terms of quality and artistry compared to the dragon tsuba I just showed you. This one is in fact signed, but going back to the basics, the shape of course is fairly classical. It has a lovely cushion shape to it, whereas the center is I would say about 4.5 mil thick. It tapers ever so slightly, gently curving to the rim, to the edge, and then the rim is then further defined as though it's an applied rim, but in fact it's not. It's part of the whole. But it gives a lovely, full, plump and gentle feeling, very elegant actually, and a lot of work to achieve that kind of understated fullness and as I say, elegance. It's not in terrible condition. There's some type of varnish, wax, incrustation on the surface, which is making it look a little bit like an out-of-date chocolate bar or lump of licorice that's oxidized. So that's going to be my focus in terms of caring for this piece. I don't think it needs a massive repatination. There's some thinness of the patina here that can be improved. And on the back, you see these little lines here. I don't know if they're visible on the camera. The little ripples. I'm not sure what that represents, but it's some form of dirt, varnish buildup. that radiates around the center, you can see little marks, little bruisings on the sepidae area, indicating that it's come off a sword. But it's a really very elegant piece. In fact, it's one of the pieces, I haven't seen a piece like this for a while that I've been so drawn to. And it's curious. The subject matter, of course, is very obvious. It's peasants in the rice fields. And here we have a bird scarer to scare away the birds who are going to steal all the baby rice plants that are being planted. And that's what's happening here. A row of farmers planting fresh rice. This, of course, being the backbone of Japanese society. Without the rice, nothing happens. And here we have a farmer plowing through the mud and the water with his heroic water buffalo, pulling away so beautifully and delicately rendered. I find the whole composition and the rendering of the people really sensitive and sympathetic, I think is the word. And it's curious because, of course, this is a samurai sword guard. It didn't go on a very big sword, so perhaps not on a katana, so not necessarily worn by a warrior. And the subject matter, of course, is interesting because it's peasants. And in the Confucian ideal of the structure of society, which was adopted by the shogunate, we had the warrior class, which was the shogun and the daimyo and the warriors themselves at the top of the pyramid. Then next strata, surprisingly perhaps, is the peasants, and that would include the farmers. The reason for that in Confucian logic is that without the peasants, there's no food. And so the peasants are given the status under the warriors. Of course, in reality, that didn't really help their position much in terms of their own well-being. And then came the artisans and the merchants last of all, because the thinking is that merchants don't produce anything at all. They just are parasites on the productive efforts of everyone else. Craftsmen are just under the farmers, of course. So I suppose I would have been all right in Edo period Japan, not being a merchant. It's a warning for all you hedge fund managers out there. Don't go back to samurai times. So we look closer at the technical aspects of the piece. We can see that there's a couple of shades of gold in evidence on the clothes, the hat of this row of peasants planting rice. There's shakudo and a little bit of shibuichi, I think, and copper, which has gone very dark for their hands and faces. And the little rice plants that are planted, tiny little slivers of gold, they're in evidence all over the piece. And really very, very delicately done. I mean, they're the tiniest little slivers. And of course, if they weren't such delicate things, the whole composition would look clunky and lack this refined feeling that we get from this very, very busy scene that's all compacted down into this tiny little guard. It really is really a lovely little piece of work when I think about the kinds of things we see in our world today. And then you look at something like this and see just how much loving care has gone into it. And I think the subject matter for me is just so charming and so, as I say, sympathetic to these people who are producing the food, and these little birds being scared off. Tiniest little details lost all over it. The artist really did warm to his subject, I think. But yes, as I say, it's one of the nicest pieces of its type I've seen in a long time. I find it very, very lovely. And this little guy on the back, all the detail in his plow as he's churning up the muddy water in preparation for planting, and the water buffalo valiantly pulling ahead. And the whole thing just makes me feel that the artist who carved all this really cared and was possibly close to the land. They were his people. but a very, very fine piece in my view. Let's hope I can bring it back so it's even more lush after I've given it some TLC, tender loving care. Now we're going to go up yet another notch. This is the work of one of the artists whose signature ranks up there with some of my favorites. There's a few artists in this tradition whose signatures are immediately recognizable, and two in particular are very, very funky. Their signatures are somewhat alike, tag calligraphy that we see in inner cities and so forth. And so Yurakucho Sekibun is one artist who's got a funky punk signature. And this artist, Seiruken Eiju, is the other one. So there's his signature, which, you know, immediately you see that, you recognize the hand of an artist who really is fairly clear about who he is. So as I say, it's one of those signatures, once you've seen one, you recognize it. Really hard to fake because it is so distinctively powerful and idiosyncratic. There's nothing about the characters here that are like anyone else's. It's a level of calligraphy beyond the formal, beyond sōshō, the more fluid script. It's now becoming very distinctively its own script. It doesn't happen by accident, of course. This is after many, many years of calligraphic practice and development. So the subject matter of these two pieces is a dragon, or are dragons. We've got a fushi, the ferrule that sits on the handle of the sword, and a kojiri. This is the metal cap that fits on the end of the scabbard. This is a fairly long one. Most frequently, they're just short, like little kashira versions. But both of these are very distinctive in the way the dragons are rendered. The kojiri is quite weighty. It weighs a touch over 100 grams. It is shakudo, of course, they're both shakudo. The material in the center, about that here, is about 1.6 millimeters thick. It tapers down to about 1.2 on the edge. And there are areas here that are in fact inlaid on top to create yet further height. But the body and the legs and so forth are intaglio. What that means is the design has been outlined with the V-chisel, and then the dragon's body and so forth is carved below the surface. So if I run a ruler across this surface, the dragon will be below the nanako. But it's a very effective design. And if I just slowly rotate this for you, you can see how lovely the whole composition wraps around. So what's worth noticing is how, let's take it around one more time, how the design clearly is focused here. Big negative space. And as it wraps over, it rolls over the canvas, leaving negative spaces, empty spaces, covered in nanako, of course, that are equally interesting. You turn that round. That in itself is just a very interesting and beautifully composed composition. And it whips around on the underside again to the tail. Almost cartoon-like, but fairly classic rendering of a Japanese dragon. Three claws, gold eyes, and a lovely study piece. As you can see, the pattern is a little bit worn in the high spots, and there's a fair bit of buildup of dirt and grime on the piece, which has to be removed. We've got some down here, verdigris, oxidized wax, and so forth. All of that can come out. You can get a hint on this side what those lovely scales will feel like and look like, rather, once they're properly cleaned up and patinated. They're quite glossy in contrast to the nanako, which is always supposed to be simulating silk fabric. So I've got high hopes for this looking really very rich and lush. And here's the kashira. So it's quite a stout piece, even though it's quite small in terms of its proportions. It's quite narrow. But the material is quite thick. The tenjogane, the copper insert, is close to 2 mil. That is always, to me, a sign of a well-made piece, a better quality piece. It seems to be a truism. The thinner the copper tenjogane, the crappier the work. So this is, it's self-evident. This is pretty robust, solid work. Nose of the dragon comes way beyond the edge. So that would be on top of the silk braid, which is always fun to see. It's not terribly uncommon. It's quite firmly attached. Again, we've got a little bit of wear, not terrible. It's mostly old oxidized wax. Once that's removed, the verdigris that's inevitably present will be a bit more visible. I will remove that and then ensure that the patina is recovered. It's a little brown in places where it's worn and then a patina's redeveloped, but it's not true black. So we've got this brownish effect on the highlights, which detracts really from what ought to be a rich, glossy, licorice black. But a great deal of relief on this piece. So as I say, it's a really powerfully sculptural piece, both in terms of the composition, just like the kojiri, but it also has a lot of volume to it. The dragon is really writhing up off the surface. It's got a great deal of depth. This is achieved by inlaying metal on top of the basic form to create the height that's required. Even the body of the dragon on the back, unlike the kojiri, which is sunken into the ground, this is all raised and quite pronounced. It's a good millimeter and a half to 2 millimeters, which on an object this small is really quite significant. But beautiful work. I always feel a little bit of a betrayer when showing you these pieces under the magnification that we are able to achieve, because this is tiny in my hands. It's under 4 centimeters long. It's an incredible amount of delicate, beautiful work, and I'm showing it to you bigger than a shoebox on your screen. And you're able to see every tiny crude chisel mark. But remember, the tools that this artist was using were literally the size of a pin. And it is an incredible privilege for us to be able to look at these things in such intimacy. In the past, of course, a handful of people would have got to see it with a little eyeglass in a court or, some very refined gathering. But now here we are on YouTube. Anybody can come along and look at this thing, at a scale that would have been unimaginable. A bit like having your medical examination broadcast. So I feel a bit like this artist's process is being violated. But I suppose the benefit to us is that we can look very carefully and understand what they achieved and how they might have gone about it, and we then stand a small chance of learning how these amazing artists worked. And I hope they'll forgive me. But I feel nothing but awe and respect and admiration and love for these artists and what they achieved. And it is a great privilege to be able to work on them and with Bella's help to film them so we can see them, really, really see them. Perhaps like they were never intended to be seen, but I think we're still rightly blown away by their marvelous achievements.